Hello, so I work here in Toulouse, but the work I will present today was mostly done in Edinburgh. And it's about Profile Explorer of Roadmap Epigenomics Data. So multicellular organisms like ourselves, we are all coming from a single cell, the egg cells, and during development, this cell gave rise to many different cellular phenotypes, such as epithelium, muscle cells, adipocytes, or neurons. All those cell types, they globally share the same genome, but they have very different phenotypes, and that's because they express their genes differently. And this differential gene expression is mostly due to cellular environments that give different signals to the cells and how the cells respond to those signals through epigenetic regulation of gene expression. Epigenetics data have been intensively studied in recent years with many existing datasets and databases, and this talk will focus on the Roadmap Epigenomics data, which contains, amongst other things, RNA-seq data, so gene expression data, DNase-1 data, which is a measure of how accessible the chromatin is, whole genome bisulfite sequencing, which is DNA methylation. They have 10 different histone methylation marks, 17 different histone acetylation marks in 33 human cell lines and tissue. So not all the histone modifications are available in the 33 cell line and tissue, but some are. And Roadmap Epigenomics data is a project is kindly providing uniformly processed data for us. So they have built a very nice data portal that you can look at to see what are the available data they provide. They also link those data to very nice genome browsers. So you can, in a few clicks, look at your favorite genes or region and see what are their epigenetic status in different cell types. They also, they and others have also done many advanced statistics on those datasets. For example, automatic classification of chromatin in different states. So you can have a look at those two. What we wanted to do was to come back to data visualizations and a bit simple regression of those data. So what we have done is looking at the mark sorted according to gene expression, and we looked at the gene start or gene promoter or transcription start sites, the gene end or transcription termination sites, and we also looked at middle exons, so not the first exon, neither the last exon, because those are TSS and TTS. And we sort those exons by expression level or inclusion ratio to see if there was any link between epigenetic marks and alternative splicing. And we have done two different analyses, one looking at all genes or exons within each cell type, and the other looking at each gene or exon individually across cell types. So I will explain those two analyses. So this slide, we look at trimethylation of lysine 4 of histone 3 at the transcription start sites in the small intestine. And I will explain each of those panels one by one because it's quite a complex figure. The first panel here, we look at the expression of 44,000 genes, so that's all the genes in the human genome from the gene code annotation, sorted according to the expression value from RNA-seq. So at the top, you have highly expressed genes, and at the bottom, you have unexpressed genes. This small color bar corresponds to the gene type of each of those genes. So expressed genes are mostly protein-coding genes. Non-expressed genes are mostly other type of genes, although there are many, many exceptions that you can't really look at this resolution. We have divided genes in five different bins of equal size according to their expression level. So the purple bin is the most highly expressed gene, and the green bin corresponds to unexpressed gene. And here you have the trimethylation status of lysine 4 of histone 3 at the transcription start site of this gene, and we are looking at a 5 kilobase region. And what you can see is that this mark is present at the promoter of expressed gene and absent at the promoter of unexpressed gene. This is the input, so our negative control, and you can see that it looks mostly flat. The bottom panel, we look at those five bins we have defined previously. So this is the distribution of expression value in the five bins. The average profile and standard error of the mean of the average profile for each of those five bins, and so for the epigenetic mark and for negative control. Here, it doesn't look that the control is this much flat, but it's not the same y-axis. So if you put this y-axis the same, then the input is really flatter than here. We have also done the same by dividing different gene types here. So it's the same mark in the same tissue, but only looking at long non-coding RNA genes. So some of them are expressed, and the ones that are expressed do have the trimethylation of lysine 4, histone 3 at their promoter. Some process pseudogenes are also expressed, but they don't show this enrichment of trimethylation of lysine 4 at the promoter. So it seems that different types of genes can show different association with epigenetic marks. We can also have a better idea about where exactly are those epigenetic marks. So here we look at chromatin accessibility through the DNase1 digestion assay. And there is a very sharp peak that seems to be a bit left of the transcription start sites. While this acetylation of lysine 27, you see two peaks right and left of the transcription start site and a gap at the exact position of the transcription start site. So we think this is due to the fact that right before the TSS, there is a nucleosome-free region. So it's very accessible, but because there is no nucleosome in this nucleosome-free region, they can't be acetylated, and that's why we have this dip here. So we did those plots at transcription start site, but we also look at exons, middle exon start, so neither the first nor the last exons, and at transcription termination site, so the end of the last exon. And you can see for this mark, trimethylation of lysine 36 of histone 3. It's not really present at the promoter, but you can see it in the gene body, and it's a bit higher at exons than at introns. And you still see it at the end of the last exon. So here you have an epigenetic mark that marks gene bodies and mostly exons, and that is positively correlated with gene expression. For DNA methylation, we actually look at four different metrics. So the CpG density in adult tissue, DNA methylation occurs mostly at CpG sites. So this is simply the distribution of the sites that can be methylated. And this density is very heterogeneous. We look at DNA methylation ratio or methylation percentage, but we also look at DNA methylation density, which is the cross product of CpG density times their average methylation percentage. And you can see that DNA methylation, if you look at it as a ratio or as a density, it can give very different profiles. And this is the whole genome bisulfite sequencing coverage. So it's our control. We expect it to be flat, and in some assay, it's nowhere near flat, unfortunately. So this is to look at those four metrics I define at exons, so DNA methylation, exonic DNA methylation in pancreas. And you can see that the ratio doesn't really change at exons compared to introns, but the DNA methylation density is very clearly marking exons. And there seems to be a bit more DNA methylation density at express exons than at not express exons. So it's also reflected here in the average profile. So this is the DNA methylation at promoter, which is negatively correlated with gene expression. That is to say that promoter DNA methylation tend to be low on genes that are expressed. This so far is the analysis that we do cell by cell, looking at all the genes within a cell type. We also did another analysis. Here we look at a single gene, here LYL1, in all different cell types. So each of those dots is one cell type or tissue. And you have on the y-axis its expression value according to RNA-seq, and on the x-axis the epigenetic status of the region of interest. So here it's transcription start site, DNA methylation. It gives you a cloud of points, and what we have done is simply a linear regression of those points, and we obtain a slope and a correlation coefficient. So here the slope is negative, and we have an R2 of 0.5. We did those regression for all the genes, and then for all the genes, we can plot the distribution of the slopes according to the R2. So low R2 mean low, well, it, low R2 means that it was probably a poor idea to do a linear regression on this cloud of points because it doesn't explain anything. And then the slope seems to be randomly distributed around zero. But for DNA methylation, as soon as the R2 becomes to be a bit more bigger, the slopes are no longer randomly distributed around zero, but they start to be strongly negative. Also, because DNA methylation ratio can only go from 0 to 1, and because expression here is measured in a log 10 matrix, we can actually quantify the strength of the association between a promoter DNA methylation and gene repression. Here, a slope of minus 2 means that when a gene becomes from fully unmethylated to fully methylated, its log 10 expression is a change of a minus 2 value, so it means 100-fold repression when going from fully unmethylated to fully methylated at the transcription start site. It's an example of an active epigenetic mark. So because we have done that on many cell types and many epigenetic marks, we have generated many, many plots, and we propose a shiny web application to explore those plots here. So you can select if you want to look at transcription start site, termination site, middle exons by expression level or inclusion ratio, the epigenetic assay you would like to look at, the cell line, and the type of genes. So there's also this compare that simply display two images side by side. So let's look at dimethylation of lysine 79. It's only available in three cell types. And we can compare here one cell type on the left and one cell type on the right. And you can see on the left, dimethylation of lysine 79 is mostly on the right-hand side of the TSS, while on the right, it's a bit like an M shape, also not very symmetrical. And this peak here is much narrower than this peak here. So we don't know yet if this difference reflects a true biological difference or if it reflects a technical problem during data generation. Here you can search for your favorite gene. So if we select a glucose transporter, here DNA methylation, eventually the regression will appear here. And then you can look at the plots I showed before. So we have generated summary tables, and in conclusion, per-epigenomics offers interesting visualizations of epigenetics data gathered by the Roadmap Epigenomics Consortium. We are currently updating those plots using new annotation data from GeneCode. A preprint and source code should be available soon, and we are planning to adopt similar approaches on the FANG data for functional annotation of the animal genomes, which aims at gathering epigenetic data for farm animal genomes. Thank you for your attention. And I would like to thank all the people that have helped me during this work and all the institutions or organizations that were critical for the realization of this work. Thank you.
Thank you for this presentation. So do we have question?
Hi, I've been checking it while you were presenting that, and I see that you can download, for example, the images as an output format. What I would be particularly interested into, can you also provide the download the aggregated data that you are providing, or right now it's just the image?
So
I'm thinking of tweaking figures further.
Yeah, the data will be available in the repository as an R data object. It's not really used in the web application because the web application, it's really a collection of pictures because those plots take some time to be created. So, I don't plan to provide it very cleanly because we are using processed data from roadmap epigenomics data. So it's really like, it's almost a bed graph file. You have your annotations and it's not that complex to obtain the matrix that is used for this picture.
Probably for us bioinformaticians, but little more for...
Sure, I'll think about it then.
Okay, thank you.
That's great work, and I think it's more of a collapse of whole genome level visualizations you have there, but I work a lot with variants, and I'm always really curious what's going on in the region. Are you planning on maybe getting some more plots that regional, that really x-axis, for example, is more the chromosome position or something, specifically when you're looking for a gene and you see kind of what's going on in the region?
So if I'm understanding the question correctly, I would say that roadmap epigenomics data already provide, the portal already provide genome browsers, linked to genome browsers. As far as I know, they didn't have done any variant calling on their data. But you can already look at the data on their genome browsers.
Yeah, no, it's just that I know they already have the chromatin states available as well. I just usually, I know they have all the imputed chromatin states as well. But I work with variants, so when I have some sort of an association with my SNPs, for example, I want to see what's going on in the region, so that's like another level I add to my annotation to just kind of figure out what's going on. And I use Jeeves, for example, to add all of those chromatin states right now to do the visualization, but I hate using it, to be honest. I was just wondering if you guys were maybe thinking about making something else with the regional stuff too. I know the browser stuff as well. It's just that they're also difficult to work with sometimes, especially when you have so many cell lines and you need to like collapse some of them and whatnot. And I was just curious.
Yeah. Well, I can also say that there are a few R packages to generate those genome browser views automatically for you if you want to. So if you just enter the data you want, the regions you want, they will generate the pictures of the tracks for you. So it can be a solution too.